government as a platform. You need to have, you know, open data, open information, etc., open the services. But it's certainly about administration, make a more transparent administration, you know, so open your information, but also the way you take decisions. And it's also political. It's about, you know, opening up the services, but also the way administrations and governments and politics take decisions. All of that is going to give you, let's say, an open government, which is necessary in order to have a more democratic, if you like, way of conducting public affairs. This is a bit of a boring slide, full of text, with the priorities in this area of empowering the public citizens and businesses priority of the government action plan. But let me just quickly say a couple of words on that. That there is a logic, there's a kind of incremental, evolution in this. They are not in order, but the first thing in order to have a democratic and open and empowering way of conducting public affairs is transparency. Technologies can do a lot in terms of transparency. Opening up, putting up information, open data, that also allows not just to be transparent, but it has a lot of value, because people, businesses can reuse that information. Open data is a very important priority these days also for the European Commission, and there's legislation in this area. Another element which is kind of going beyond transparency and putting your data for reuse by other people is to design things, services, public services, in a way that puts the user, the citizen, the business in the center, which is easy to say and not always to do. Then you would have another step, which is to involve citizens and business actors in the way policy is conducted. And the last level would be to have collaborative production of governmental services. So, sorry, they are not in order, but I put my one order there. I will go quickly on this one. I would like just to say that from the side of the European Commission, European institutions, there's various programs that support work in the area of the government. So for those interested, I put up this thing just to say, over the years, there's quite a few years of support in the area. And these projects are very different, but in practice, it will be funding, for instance, for local authority, for some local authorities, in order to experiment with using IT tools in order to communicate with citizens, to give you an example. So for those interested, they can follow up, and the Commission does intend to continue supporting this area. I think I will go quickly on this one, otherwise we won't make it on time. So that's about very roughly things that the European Commission is doing in the area of the government. And as I said, I talk about perspective. There's many of these projects that are in the particular area of e-participation and e-democracy. There is even a specific action that was launched at the initiative of the European Parliament and then managed by the European Commission on e-participation. Now, a bit of a more general reflection. I've been using different terms. I mean, I understand that e-democracy, a bigger concept would be e-participation, and e-government would be even more encompassing. I'm not very clear on these definitions, on these different terms, but never mind. This slide, I don't know if you can see it, is a bit old, but the point I'm trying to make is that there's many things that you can do with technologies in the area of e-democracy and politics and public services. But many of the things which are done so far are in terms of political communication, so communicating. There's also consultations, and then actually surprisingly when it comes to voting, there's much less of it, and when it comes to actually engaging citizens actively in public affairs, there's even less. So as I said, many terms are used today: democracy, participation, policy 2.0. This is a new term that is more and more used. Well, policy 2.0. What can I say? I think taking a very broad reflection, one should take a step back and recognize that, I mean, the governments, administrations, politicians, they have many, many challenges today. You know, doing politics and doing administration is a very challenging thing today. And that's in part due to the very fact that technologies are so pervasive and everything is connected. A crisis today becomes a worldwide crisis immediately. People are connected. It's all very challenging. We hear about the state getting smaller, reducing the role of the state, but it's not sure. Some people question that. I mean, because these days we're seeing in Europe that actually the state, governments, they have to intervene a lot. If it wasn't for the state, we would be perhaps even more trouble. So that's our goal. But anyway, let's come to technologies. It's clear that technologies, they offer a lot of potential for governments, for politicians. But there's different ways in which this can be used. And this can be said this morning. That can be a perfect tool for autocracy, for censorship, for dictatorship. Very powerful tool. And on the other extreme, it can be, you have models or utopian type of distributed democracy that are also possible and enabled by technologies. So perhaps one wants to find a middle way whereby, you know, technologies deliver better government services to the citizens. This is actually a chart from one of our projects, which is the policy cycle, chart. This is called. I mean, there's several like this around in academia, in research. As I said before, I think when one talks about e-democracy, and I repeat, it's important to not think only of elections or specific decisions. Democracy is more, should be, I think, that it's more of a continuous thing that happens every day. Democracy is, well, that was invented in Greece, you know, better than nobody the definition of a worldwide Greece, but I think it's more about involving citizens on a continuous basis. And according to this model, it identifies different phases. There would be a first phase, which would be designing a policy. You would first setting the agenda, design the policy, adopting some policy, implementing it, and then monitor the impact and results. So what I'm trying to say is that in all these phases of politics and of delivering government services, of course technologies can play a role. And there's a whole array of technologies out there that, you know, governments are experimenting with. Technologies around open and big data, visual analytics, modeling and simulation, collaborative government, crowdsourcing, serious gaming, opinion mining. I mean, those are things that exist, that companies are using there, but also governments have at their disposal. So some examples. I think there's very much, this has been said this morning by several speakers, there's very much a focus on elections, so that some politicians, many, focus a lot on the power of technologies when there is an election coming up. And then often, after the election is gone, then the interest in technologies decreases. There's examples of politicians that have set up Twitter accounts and blogs and what have you, very active, and after the election, those things were not used anymore. But next to that, IT are used a lot for in government in the area of at the stage of adopting policies, debating and things like that. So that's an example. I won't go into detail. That, for instance, the European Commission used. Another interesting area that we see more and more, also very much at local level, is all this area around implementation with these applications. So combining the power of open data and peer-to-peer applications for, related to transport, the environment, signaling graffiti in the street and sending back the picture. Many local authorities are experimenting that and using this. In the policy cycle, the last but very important bit is about evaluating and monitoring. And this is very important for democracy, actually, because it's about accountability. So making sure that what has been promised in elections or by politicians is actually done. This is an example of an application that in Italy that serves to monitor the use of European funds. So people go there and actually see if what was planned was actually done with European funds. I would like just to finish with a couple of reflections of my own, because over the years the Commission, European Commission, like other administrations, it's fashionable, if you like, to try and experiment with tools, IT tools online, to try to do what we do and communicate with citizens and engage, which is fine. I can be a bit critical with ourselves and say, well, it's fine, but we need to do more, and the impact is limited so far, so we need to do better. So just three slides about things that I think are important in order to, I repeat, for, in this case, public administrations, governments, if you like, to use efficiently technologies to engage with people, with citizens, with business, and contribute to, if you like, e-democracy. The first thing is, it's not a two-way conversation. Very often, from administrations, we tend to launch consultations, and actually, it's like a mailbox. You consult about something, people send emails, and the other people, they don't actually say what the others are saying. So I think what's important is these many-to-many conversations, possibility of being transparent. And this is an example from something that we did last year. It's called the Digital Agenda. Well, Digital Agenda is, I mentioned before, is this overall strategy for the European strategy for electronic, for digital economy. And we kind of crowdsourced opinions about how to reshape that agenda. And it was important to actually show the comments that everybody was putting. And that sounds a bit stupid, a bit simple, but I mean, very often, also from us, from European institutions, we, for many years, when we launched consultation, it was not possible to see online what the others had commented. Whereas with this approach, people can comment and comment on comments. Very simple stuff, but it's a very important step. Very important also to provide feedback. We saw, I mean, people are commenting, posting. If you don't react in 2 days or in the same day, you lose your users, the citizens that you want to reach. And to be very clear about how you are capturing the feedback and how you're acting on it. Almost done. It's not about direct democracy. What is it that I mean? It's very important to manage, in my experience, expectations from people. Because, as I said before, it's in fashion from administrations, from politicians today, to launch consultations. But you need to be very clear, I would say, what are you going to do with the feedback from people? Because very often, and I've seen it, over the years, these consultations, these debates which are launched, and then people at the end of the day, they don't see the impact at all on their opinions that I've expressed. So therefore, I think it's important, at least in my experience, that first you decide what it is that you're going to do in terms of a policy decision, legislation, what have you, and how you incorporate the online tools, if you like, rather than the other way around. Let's launch a debate or something, and then we will see how we use the results. In my experience, what's very important is actually to convince the deciders, your politician, your commissioner, or what have you, that actually, with the results of that discussions, you can do something afterwards. It's not about total openness. Well, I think this issue of e-democracy on a day-to-day basis, I repeat, not just at the time of elections, and that's important, should be something that you do progressively, in an incremental way. Perhaps you don't want to crowdsource your whole whole backend or your whole strategy, but you can start from a small tiny area. And in that, local authorities are better sometimes because they decide to be smaller. For instance, there are cases of cities that decide to crowdsource 10% of their budget. So it's limited, it's credible, I would say. And it's important to educate by being progressive. And not just to educate the citizens, the users, but very often to educate the civil servants in order to open up their minds in terms of what can be done online. And the problem that is not about local citizens. This is a chart from what we did last year with this crowdsourcing, if you like, of our strategy. And actually you find that few people come, and those that comment are very often a limited number of people. That's very typical. So you have a problem of representativity. You want to take a decision, and then you find out that at the end of the day, 40, 50 people have commented in significant numbers, and the others just want to comment. How can you propose something at European level with such a low level of representativity? I think this is an issue that many people have. Perhaps around the time of an election, there's more of an activity going on, but in between elections, it's difficult to attract participation. And then it's very often very polarized. I mean, you have extreme positions there, so it's very difficult to do something about it. I suppose that in order to counter that, what you need to do is, like companies do, target the people that you are really want to target. To give an example, if you want to propose something about broadband rollout, you need to make a market research before to see who are the people you want to target. And something that we try and do, there's many things to do on the internet. So don't expect people are just gonna come to you. They have other things to do. Go where they are, go to the forums that in this case where broadband is discussed, and try and reach not just everybody, but those people that are the real multipliers, those that have an impact on others. And today it's easy to see who is influential on the internet, but it requires a bit of work. And give incentives to people to participate. And the best incentive is to be clear about what you're going to do. Listen, I want opinions about broadband rollout because I intend to propose a regulation about it. That's actually something that we did last year. And then people understand, oh, perhaps they really want to do something about my opinion, and they contribute. So just to finish, what I basically tried to say is that from the perspective of the European institutions, in particular from the European Commission, I was going to say a lot, but at least there's things that are done in terms of promoting e-government in general, and then e-participation, democracy in particular, applying it to ourselves. As I said, we heard this morning some examples from the European Parliament, but also try and support others, like authorities from member states, from local communities, regions, in order to try to use technologies in order to do democracy on a day-to-day basis, if you like. Which is, I repeat, it's not just around elections, it's about designing new policies, it's about implementing them, it's about monitoring them. So technologies give many, many possibilities in terms of quantity. You can reach lots of people, you can provide lots of information. In terms of quality as well, you can process lots of information, you can anticipate, you can model your policy, and many possibilities. But of course, it has been said this morning by several speakers, technology is not a substitute for democracy. That's clear, we all agree on that. And it's not gonna be there's no button that you push and that makes your administration wonderful. But at the same time, it's also fair to say that politics and administration, government need a bit of a revamp. Many people agree on that. And that technology can help with that. But actually, the barriers, from my experience and from our projects and what we find out, the barriers are very often not technology barriers, because technology allows anything. They are very often organizational, cultural, and so forth. So that was all for me. Thank you very much, Christo.